Because at least you can get heroin all year round, can't you? So. There's a sort of a really delayed laugh from Tom over there, I like that. I've got the face only a mother could love. Well, that's what Dad used to say anyway. Just more sad than funny, isn't it? Who else I want to talk to? It's really, suddenly all those lights are on. I can't, so I'm going to get closer. And who are you sitting with? Sorry, it's James. And who are you with? What's your name? Your wife? And so I imagine she's got a name. I don't think that's like her identity. Name's what, sorry? Poi. And what do you do, Poi? An insurance company. What sort of insurance? Motor insurance. Oh, I'd say try to sell me insurance, but I don't drive a car. If I did drive a car, try to sell me some insurance. Oh, what do you do in the insurance company? Oh, right, so if I had an injury, you could... So say I crashed my car, which I don't have, and broke my arm. I suppose that would be... It wouldn't sell me insurance after I broke my arm. That would be terrible, wouldn't it? That's not how it works. someone with a funny job. Make up a funny job that you've got. Oh, I don't know, a turtle balancer. Yeah? What's the best turtle you've ever balanced? A little baby, like a terrapin. That's good, like a micro machine car, you can balance it on your little finger. Yeah. Just things from the 90s. Are you all right? You just gave me quite a funny look, like, what is he talking about? So I'm going to talk to you. Are you all right? You all right, what are you drinking? Lemonade. Oh, how disappointing. I'm really struggling with this microphone lead. Sorry. There we go. That's a bit better. I feel like Indiana Jones right now. Oh, it's really knotted up. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to break something. I'm better than Indiana Jones, actually, because I've never crashed a plane. So, yeah. Paul Harrison. Is he all right? Is he out of hospital yet, Tom? I thought you would. You love him. I love Indiana Jones. Right. Fair enough. What else have we got to talk about? Who else has got an interesting story for the day? What have they been doing today? No one. Everyone's had a really boring Saturday, have they? You can ask questions. You want to ask a question, Adam? Do you want to? You're live broadcasting. That's amazing. Come and film everyone live. What are you live broadcasting on? Wave to Adam's live broadcasting. That's amazing. The wonders of technology. That's weird. It's what a time to be alive, eh? I can just talk to a mobile phone and he can pretend someone is watching. I reckon the phone's probably not even on. His camera's shot. Who is this guy? What is going on? Can I have a look? Come and film and I want to have a look. This is terrible MC.
No. Ugh, that's me.
That's you. But yeah, he's writing comments down.
It's handsome bloke, isn't he? Oh, ugh, put it away. I can't.
This must be very strange for everybody else. Yeah. Apologies.
Show them. What has he put? Hello. Uh-huh. Is this the guy?
That's the guy, yeah.
Get a real job, mate.
Coming from someone that does this. Yeah. I'm not performing. I'm just the warm-up person. This isn't me performing. That sounds a bit weird. I'm just sort of trying to get everyone... Because it's fucking cold in here, isn't it, guys? You've still got your jumper on. So that's why I'm blaming that for why I'm going really badly. Yeah. Right. Clap it really loud. Bring it up. Much louder. Stamp your feet a little bit. All right, can you please welcome to the stage Mr. Tom Barrett.
Hello. Thank you for that entirely forced applause. But it's all... fucking hell. It's always nice to walk out to that kind of applause because it means most of you haven't seen me do this before. I don't normally do it at these nights, but my sister and her husband are here tonight and they haven't left the house in 3 years, so I thought I'd better. There's nothing wrong with them, they just had a baby. These are mine. I'll just explain what these are. Basically, if you've ever seen the news, this is very similar to what they have on there. I'm sure some of you watch the news. Maybe you look like someone that watches the news. You, I'm not so sure about. Maybe on a Sunday, you're thinking, oh, I've got to be back on work on Monday. Better watch the news so I've got something to talk about. Then you'll sidle up to someone and say, so what about that economy? What's going on with that? And they'll say, well, actually, I know exactly what's going on with that. And they'll display a level of detail that you hadn't even thought about. I know you don't do that. I do that. I'm projecting. but sometimes when they're on the news, they'll have these images next to them to just accurately display what's happening as it's happening. This isn't comedy, by the way. I'm not entirely sure what it is, but I know it's definitely not comedy. The good news is that it's not anti-comedy either. So I don't want any of you thinking that I'm like up here purposely trying to be unfunny, okay? I am trying as hard as I possibly can to be funny, and I just need you to bear with me for a little while. Also, it's not comedy, and it's not anti-comedy either. So what that means is if you can find anything to laugh at, please do. I encourage it, if anything. You might even want to laugh at that, if you think about it, because that is it's a not joke, isn't it? Thank you. Cheers. So all it is really is just some things like this. This is a thing, and the thing that this is quite clearly what this thing is this thing is what the inside of a pomegranate looks like. I think you'll agree I've got the right shapes and colours there. That's what the inside of a pomegranate looks like, and that's what it feels like. Yeah? It's bad, isn't it, right? And not just because a pomegranate is small, like sort of too small. It's also because a pomegranate is inherently scary. It is, right? I didn't see a pomegranate until about 25. I didn't eat a lot of fruit growing up, mainly crisps. Something when I was younger, going into prawn cocktails as an adult. It's funny how you taste mature as you get older, isn't it? But then I saw this pomegranate, and I saw this person open it up, and all these little fruits came out of the one big fruit. And to me, any number of little things coming out of one big thing is inherently scary. I see no difference between pomegranates and spiders' eggs. Is this accessible enough? Because sometimes I worry that I'm not accessible, because I can do accessible. Like, if you want accessible, that's accessible. Yeah? I hate queues. Who hates queues? I hate queues. Yeah, and you're probably sitting there thinking, well, I wonder if Tom hates queues for the same reason that I hate queues. Well, I might surprise you, because the reason that I hate queues, too long. It's too long. There are too many letters there for what is essentially a monosyllabic word. You could easily spell it like that, and no one would be any the wiser. I mean, you could go one further. You could spell it like that. Or like that, if you're American. But I do think there's a purer spelling of the word Q, which would actually be that one there. It's the same amount of letters, but it's the same letter repeated, so there is an economy there. And I know what your argument against that will be. You'll be saying, well, actually, Tom, there's two different definitions of the word Q, and that's why we have the two different spellings to differentiate. Well, what I would say to that is you can easily squash these two together and create a Venn diagram for describing the two different types of Q. And you're right not to laugh. That's essentially flawed logic, right? Because there's no way you could use a Venn diagram to describe that. I mean, imagine if that's like a queue in Sainsbury's over here. There's a music queue there. What the fuck goes in the middle? That's just some lines drawn on a pig. You might have seen that like in a butcher's or a textbook at the butcher's. But what this means, this is a really handy like visual diagram for recognizing meat, because I do struggle with meat. I'm 30 years old and I'm still not entirely sure what it is. Like, if I look down at myself, I'm not sure where the meat would come from. I mean, this is mainly fat and bone, but what meat is that part. If it's on a pig, it's meat. If it's on me, it's not meat. That's the way it works. Some of this stuff is pretty hard hitting, guys. That's a spade. I will not be silenced. Give me a number between 6 and 8. Fuck! That will work one night and it's going to be amazing. These are good. These are just some non-specific cheeses. And they're really non-specific as well. Like this one over here starts out as one of your rounded cheeses, like perhaps an Edam. But then it goes down into a point like Parmesan. So that could be maybe Edamizan, perhaps. This one over here starts life as one of your round cheeses, like perhaps a goat's cheese. But then it goes back into a block. And the thing is, right, these aren't coloured in. So that could be red Leicester. That could be cheddar. There's literally no way of knowing. Right. Now, this one down here, that is fucking mental, okay? Because it starts out looking like a Battenberg. That's not a cheese. That's a cake, if anything. But then in the back, it's holed like a Swiss or an Emmental. But if that is Battenberg, that's now making me question the nature of those other two. Like, that might not even be goat cheese. That could be anything, like a battery or an ovum. it's just a dog doing a play. Mexican dog, I reckon, although he is an actor, so there's no way of knowing. Oh, this bit's good. This is the ultimate BuzzFeed personality quiz. Could I have your favourite colour, please?
Blue.
Interesting, because you got Wolverine! That's right, you're tough as old nails with a serious past. Anyone who messages you, sure, better think twice. You never shy away from a fight, and you're always courageous. Beneath that roughy, tufty exterior, there beats a heart of purest gold. Your wit, loyalty, and courageousness are enough to win over anyone. Except for Dr. Jean Grey, who will never love you. that's probably the high point of my set, guys, so I think I'll leave you with that. Thank you very much. You've been fantastic. You've got a great night of comedy coming up with you. I'm going to hand you back to your MC, Rob Saunders.
Right, we're going to start clapping and cheering again, guys. Yeah. Bit louder. Bit louder. All right, please welcome to the stage, Joe FLETCHER-CROSS.
Good evening. Thank you for that rapturous welcome. I have got a bit of a reputation as quite a calm person, quite chilled, quite cool, and I think that's fair. I think I am. You know, I look at myself and I think, yeah, I'm pretty cool in any situation. I've also got a bit of a reputation as quite a nice person, quite a good person, and because I know what goes on in my head, I think that's not fair enough. I don't think I am, because I think the worst thing that I do is I bear terrible, terrible grudges. I'm really bad for it. I think, and I'm really bad for, you know, when you replay conversations in your head and think, I could have done them so much better. Does anyone else do that? Yeah, because I used to think it was just me until I started to admit it, and then everyone's like, yeah, I do that. But I think I am worse, because I do it all the time. I leave the house in the morning, and I've got about a 25-minute walk from my house to the train station, and pretty much every morning I leave the house cheerful, happy, sun's rising, oh, the daffodils are out, oh, there's blossom on the trees. And somewhere between my front door and the station, things start to creep into my head. Conversations come back to me. And by the time I get there, you know, I've kind of started off with, oh, puppies, sunshine, oh, I wish I'd said that better, I wish I'd come up. And by the time I get to the station, I am raging in a proper lather. And I've got, you know, I've got favourites that I go back to. I don't know if anyone else does this, where you think, oh, yeah, let me try that one again. I'll give you an example. I used to live in London, and I was on the tube one day, and I was just sitting, I was kind of a bit zoned out, as you do, and this woman and her husband and their son, who was about 7 years old, got on the tube, and they sat down next to me. The woman sat down next to me, and she sat on my coat slightly, and I pulled it up, as you do, not particularly angrily, and then I zoned out again, and about a few minutes later, I realised that they were talking about me, you know, when you become aware of something on the periphery, and I tuned in. She was like, oh, it's true what they say, and it's true what, I don't know where she was from, it's true what they say. You know, these Londoners, they're so unfriendly, aren't they? Yeah, I can't wait to get back to the north. And I was raging. I'm not even from London, so you know, I was really pissed off. So what I did was I gave a really witty retort that showed her who was boss. That's not what happened. No way is that what happened. What actually happened is that I realised I was about to get off. It was my stop. So I got up, and I went to the door. And the door opened, and I went, fuck you! And I jumped off the train. Beep, 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 door's closed. That was it, yeah. It's not my finest hour. Not my finest hour. The worst thing about this story is that this was 12 years ago. 12 years. Has that woman given me a second thought since that happened? No, she has not. Have I thought about it almost every day since it happened? Yes, I have. I have. Because why? Because I am a terrible, bitter, bitter person. I'm really bitter. But it turns out that has worked out quite well for me, because my day job, what I do when I'm not making you all laugh, is I'm a journalist. So being bitter really helps there. And I'm a bit nervous about admitting I'm a journalist, because we're not very popular at the moment, you know, phone hacking, etc. People think we're shits. You know, you go to parties and there's a bit of a hierarchy as to who wants to talk to, you know, with people that don't want to be sat next to you. So, you know, they're like, oh, you're a journalist. And I'm always like, well, you know, I'm a nice journalist. I'm not one of these, you know, I don't work for the Sun or anything. I work for a wedding magazine. I'm a nice wedding magazine. You know, it's all hearts and flowers. And it genuinely is quite nice. You know, it's all about your perfect day. You know, what flowers are you going to have on your perfect day? What dress are you going to wear on your perfect day? What are your bridesmaids going to wear on your perfect day? What kind of cake will you have on your perfect day? What kind of buffet are you going to put on your perfect day? What's the entertainment going to be on your perfect day? On your perfect fucking day. Your perfect fucking day every fucking day. That's my life. That's my life every fucking day. So it's not as bad as it sounds. It's really nice. But I am the editor of the magazine, and as such, I'm considered an expert, and I get asked quite often, what's hot in weddings? What's hot in weddings, editor of Wedding Magazine? And I say, well, you know, I make it up, basically, but I'm going to let you into a secret on what's hot in weddings. What's hot in weddings right now, ladies and gentlemen? What's hot is owls. Owls. I shit you not. Owls. This is genuine. How it works is your owl, I don't know, wrangler, handler, whatever you call a person who deals with owls on a daily basis is, they turn up at your wedding and they get your wedding rings and they put them in a little pouch and they tie it to the leg of the owl. I don't think they've got arms, that would be a whole other subsect. But they tie it to the leg of the owl and it shoots up the aisle and delivers the rings to the best man, who then hands it over to the groom and the wedding continues. And I have never been to a wedding where this has happened. I can't really believe that it happens, except I've seen photographs of it, so I know that it does. So can you imagine, you're at a wedding and you're sitting there and you know you're gussied up in your nice outfit and you're looking around. Hi, looking nice, yeah. Oh, who's wore the white dress? That was a mistake. Oh, Auntie Hilda's got a nice hat, there we go. Oh, here comes, there's the bride. That's fun. Doesn't she look nice? Yeah, there we go. What the fuck was that? It was Hedwig with the rings. That's it. Yeah, this is weird. So I genuinely had a conversation with a woman who runs an owl business of this type in Norfolk. And she had a very long rant to me about how there's a lot of amateur owls out there spoiling it for the professional owls. You know, and I think, well, there's a fine distinction there, isn't there? You know, how does it work? You know, amateur owls, they're good, but they're not good enough to be paid for their job just yet. Whereas the professional owls, they're out there like killer ninja owls out there, you know, shooting through, doing the business. So that's the kind of weird world that I operate in on a daily basis. So, you know, it is pretty weird. And I'm constantly reminded that I'm a bit of a failure, frankly, because as an expert in weddings, I should be, you know, all pro weddings. And I did get married a few years ago for the second time, and that's the key thing. I'm divorced. Ooh, is anyone else divorced out here? You're all... No, just me. I did feel like a failure, but I don't anymore, because I read a magazine feature a few years ago that said that this is the cool thing to do now, and I was pretty happy because I've caught the zeitgeist. What you do is you get married very young, get divorced, and then get married again, and they called it starter marriages. I thought, starter? I've had a starter marriage. It's great, isn't it? Like your first house, you know, that kind of boxy Barrett home that you buy, or your first car, that cheap little runaround, which is not an unfair description of my first husband, which is why we're now divorced. But I thought I was 20 and he was 21. We were pretty young when we got married. But I felt I was mature and ready. And looking back, there are signs that he was not quite there yet. I went out to buy him a present. You know, traditionally you'd buy each other a present to have on the day of the wedding. And I went out and searched for the most beautiful present I could find for him. I thought, I'm going to get him an antique kilt pin, because I'm from Scotland. He's also Scottish. We married in Scotland. I don't know if you've come across a kilt pin or you know what it is. It's essentially a brooch. It's a manly brooch for your skirt. So I went out and looked for one, and I found this beautiful antique one, silver. You know, it had his clan on it. It was ancient. It cost me £100. I was really proud of it, and I wrapped it up carefully and I gave it to the best man. I said, you know, give this to him on the morning of the wedding, and he can wear it proudly as he walks down the aisle. And then I thought, God, I really hope he's got me something. He was shit at presents, really, really bad. So I thought, I bet he doesn't bother to get me anything. You know, so I kind of steeled myself for that. And on the morning of the wedding, you know, I was getting ready with my bridesmaids. The photographer was there taking pictures of us and our, you know, hair getting done in our dressing gowns, drinking champagne. And my bridesmaid said, I've got a present from you from him. And I was really excited. I'm like, oh my God, he's remembered. And the photographer was there ready to take the picture of me opening up this present from my husband-to-be, this man I was going to marry in a few hours, to see what beautiful thing he'd got me, to express his love for me and say how much he wanted to be married to me. So there, this present, I thought it was going to be jewellery, isn't it going to be something beautiful? And she came through with a box, you know, about this size. I thought, well, that's not diamonds, but, you know, that's fine. I'm going to open up. I'm going to see what it is, you know. And it was quite beautifully wrapped and a ribbon on. I've untied the ribbon. I thought, he's got me. Yeah, ready for the photograph. I'm going to open it up. Open it up. See what it is. He's got me a Furby. A Furby. Now, a limited edition Gremlins Furby, to be fair. But a Furby nonetheless, and this was in the year 2000, so it was one of those kind of first edition shit Furbies. It doesn't do all your kind of talking to each other that they do now. It just sat there and went, bing, 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 bing. That was it. That's what he got me to express his love for me. So yeah, as you can tell, I have borne a grudge about that for quite some time. But now I've come across the solution, because I'm going to send in the professional owls. So that's all I've got time for this evening. Thank you very much. You've been beautiful.
Give up for Joe FLETCHER-CROSS, that was amazing. Louder. All right, please welcome to stage Julia Watson.
Hello. Oh, I've never done a gig in a police station before, Especially one that looks like we're pretty much in a room where they kept all of the evidence. That's what it looks like to me. So hello, I just want to say a quick thank you. That was a really nice welcome. Basically, that welcome is like the most action I've had in months. So seriously, thank you for that. I did get wolf whistled the other day. Yes, quite happy about that. But it was by a pigeon. Don't think you can count that one, can you? No. I'm just going to move this mic stand very, very quickly. Look. Yeah, see, I'm a little bit worried because I'm approaching 30 now, and I'm worried that that pigeon might be my last chance for true love. Okay? It's a bit worrying that bestiality is looking like a pretty decent plan B for me. It's not good. It's not good. I'm at that age now where all my friends are sort of like settling down, getting married and having children, but I'm not really there. If I'm honest, I'm too irresponsible to produce the human child that comes out of me. No, I'm too irresponsible for that. I'll give you an example. The other day I ran out of toothpaste, so decided to improvise with a jar of mint sauce. It's not the same thing, people. It's not the same thing. I'm lazy too, I'm really lazy. Like recently I've been seriously considering moving to a country that begins with the letter A, purely because I waste so much time filling out those online forms trying to find the UK somewhere down there at the bottom. I don't have time for that. My family are always on at me as well because I think they've got to that age now where they're desperate for some grandkids, and unfortunately I'm not the one that's going to give them the grandkids. And they sort of say to me things like, oh, Julia, you're so picky. You're so picky. You're always on at me. But it's not really fair because they come from that generation where everything was kind of rushed. You know, you sort of had to fall in love, marry that person, have a baby, have a house, all of that, and bish, bash, bosh. And we're from a much more sort of relaxed, different generation. Like, my parents rushed that so quickly, that process, that they failed to notice that they both had the same surname. This is true, they both had the same surname, and it's kind of worrying to think that my family tree might be a family shrub. It's very worrying. Like, if you're on a date tonight, some of you might be out on a date tonight, and you turn to the person that you're sort of like out here with, and you find out that one of the things that you have in common is your DNA. Don't reproduce, okay? At least have 6 degrees of separation before you procreate, at least. I think that's the rule anyway. But yeah, I'm not actually picky. I'm not. I just have a niche taste in men. It's just one of those things. See, I like the older man. I do. But I know some of you are looking at me, and I know what you're thinking. And I'm not talking your sort of traditional sexy silver foxes, no. No, you can keep your Richard Gears, your George Clooney's, your Dumbledore's. I'm not interested. No, not for me. No, see, I like old, fat, balding men. That is what it is for me. I'm basically a reverse paedophile. I don't need to go out on dates. I just hang around bus stops with a packet of Werther's Originals. Damn my knickers. Works a treat. Yeah, by the way, when I say, like, old, fat, balding men, I'm specific as well. Like, they have to have a proper gut on them. You know the guys that look like they kind of swallowed a bowling ball? I like that. It's nice. And my friends say things to me like, oh, Julia, doesn't it bother you that they're, you know, sort of going bald and they've got no hair? No, it's fine. It's fine. Because what they lack on their head, they make up for on their back anyway. Oh, it's nice. You can, like, pet them at night and things. Oh, so sweet. One of the best things about dating older guys, for me anyway, is you rarely have to have that sort of awkward moment where I have to meet their parents. Yeah, that's what I look for in a guy. No in-laws. None. Yeah, so the last guy I was seeing, we split up, so I am single again now. And I realise I'm really not very good at being single. I'm not. And my friends like to rub this in my face. They do. I received a wedding invitation the other day from my friend who's getting married in 2017. 2017. Now, I looked that wedding invitation over back to front, and there was no plus one box on there for me to tick. None. She had, however, bless her, taken the time to list the different main courses I might want to eat on her happy day. So basically, my friend thinks that in 2 years' time, I'm more likely to be hungry than in a relationship. That is not a friend, is it? That is not a friend. But it's okay, because I've got this plan right. I'm hoping that within the next 2 years, scientists perfect human cloning. Because I want to see her face when I turn up to her wedding arm in arm with an exact replica of the groom. Can you imagine the wedding speeches? I can't wait. She's up there gushing about how lucky she is because there's no one else in the world quite like Dave. And I turn up like, yes, there is. There is, bitch. There is. No, like I say, I'm too lazy. I wouldn't wait 2 years for scientists to perfect human cloning. I'd probably just take that pigeon. I could do worse. I could do worse. I've always had this kind of like strange taste in men, people tell me. Like my first ever crush was actually a Disney cartoon character. Has everyone here seen the film Aladdin? Yes, yeah. Yeah, see, I had the biggest crush on Jafar. He's hot, right? He's hot. Yeah, see, as a child, I would often fantasize about what it would be like to be Jafar's girlfriend. Like, can you imagine? I'd often ask him things like, tell me, Jafar, what turns you on? And he'd always respond with, world domination, my dear. It's hot. But see, it's affected me because any guy that I meet now just doesn't seem as ambitious. No. Disney kind of set the bar quite high for me. It's probably the reason I've got a warped sense of like love and achievement. It hasn't sort of done me any good because I'm not with my Prince Charming and I don't live in a castle. And I don't know what it is that I'm doing wrong because, you know, I'm always singing to the local wildlife. I make sure that I insist on only travelling by pumpkin. And whenever I go to a party, I make sure to leave one shoe behind in the hope that there's some royalty there with a foot fetish. But no, I'm living on my own in a one-bedroom flat. I kind of describe myself as really independent, which is like a nice way of saying, I'm lonely, so lonely. Oh my God, I am lonely. Strong, independent woman. It's funny because it's true. I'll give you an idea of how lonely I am. The last text message on my phone is from Domino's Pizza. It's true. Up to a point recently, I did have some goldfish for company, but I came to despise them because they were having more sex than me. No, and they had their own castle. That is rubbing it in. So I ate them. Fuck them. I don't need them. I don't need them. I kind of got to the point where I'm so ashamed of being single that whenever I go to the supermarket now, I started buying two of everything. Yeah, to get this illusion that it's not just me on my own. And basically, my trolley in the supermarket looks like a Noah's Ark of pre-packed, butchered animals floating on a sea of my own tears, which is only worth like 10 club card points. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. Now, I know that I'm not Disney princess glamorous. I'm more sort of straight to DVD bargain bucket. That is me, and I'm fully aware of that. But, thank you for listening, guys. What have we learnt from tonight? We've learnt that basically I'm looking for an old, fat, balding man with his own castle. I don't think it's too much to ask, really. Purely because I'd like to be able to, next time I get a wedding invite, just tick that plus one box and feel confident that I'll have someone to take with me. Thank you very much for listening. You have been a really lovely audience. You've got a great night ahead. I have been Julia Watson. Thank you.
Give it up for Julia. That was amazing.
Julia was there talking about bald people. I'm going bald. It's quite sad. But I was coming to terms with it. Until when recently my girlfriend pointed out that it's in the shape of a cock and balls, my bald spot. Yeah, so there we go. I think it's punishment for all the times I'm a dickhead. which is quite a lot. I'm not a horrible person, I'd like to think, but a dickhead. Like we recently went to Rome, and when we were there, whenever she'd ask me if I wanted to do something, I would reply, "Well, when in Rome." Every time. And we were in Florence, and she asked me if I wanted to do something, and I said, "Well, when in Rome." She said, "Rob, we're not in Rome." Well, all roads lead to Rome, don't they? See? Dickhead. My favourite, though, is if we're ever at a train station, I'll always say, don't stand in front of the yellow line, otherwise you might get sucked off. That's my favourite one. See? Dickhead. A massive dickhead. Literally now, which is a shame. So that's it. All you young people, don't be a dickhead. You won't end up like me. I entered a karate competition the other day. I came last. Whew, I was kicking myself. I was really good at handwriting when I was at school. Straight A's. A couple of jokes for you there. Are we going to start clapping and cheering and stuff for the next act? That's good, you just bring it down. I'm going to exert my power a little bit more. I like it. we've got one more act, and we're going to have a little break, and then we're going to have a sporting event, the USOL Hyper Bowl after. Are you excited about that? Yeah. All right, so we're going to start clapping for the last act of this bit. Yeah, does that sound good? All right, so start clapping. A bit louder. Louder still. All right, please welcome to the stage, Dilly Dolls.
Les étoiles, dites-moi étoiles, pourquoi je vous regarde. Les étoiles, dites-moi étoiles, qui vous regardera. Volato, lato, rato, lado. Les étoiles, si seulement je savais. Dites-moi étoiles, de qui obtenez-vous la lumière? Les étoiles, vous qui êtes belles dans les cieux. Dites-moi étoiles, qui vous donnera l'amour? Volato, lato, rato, lado. Tell the stars why I look to you. Les étoiles, dans pourquoi je vous regarde. Les étoiles, dites-moi étoiles, pourquoi je vous regarde. Les étoiles, les étoiles. Dites-moi étoile qui vous regardera. La do, 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 les étoiles, les étoiles, si seulement je sais bien. Dites-moi étoile qui vous donnera l'amour. La do, 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 la do.
Ha 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 ha!
The stars, lights of white and blue. Tell me, stars, why I love you.
For Dilly Dolls. It's amazing. Right, we're gonna have a quick 10-15 minute break and we come back and we'll have the comedy hyper bowl. Oh, exciting. Who's gonna win? You don't even know the contestants yet, but you will. Oh, you will.